Professor Hans. And before I do that, I should thank Professor Govind for introducing and getting Professor Hans here. Professor Hans is a professor in Antwerp Systems and Software Modeling Group with an acronym ANSIMO. It's in the Department of Mathematics and Computer Science at the University of Antwerp in Belgium. He is also an adjunct professor in the School of Computer Science at McGill University, and he used to teach full-time at McGill University for almost a decade, and then he recently moved to Antwerp. And his lab does a lot of interesting work, both theoretical as well as applied, with a lot of interaction with industry in Belgium. And he heads, his lab is called the Modeling, Simulation and Design Lab, and it's a distributed lab. Looks yes. like both in Antwerp and McGill.
And heterogeneous.
And
so it's cyberphysical.
Yeah. And today he's going to talk about this particular topic of how do you model, heterogeneous systems. And welcome and look forward to your talk.
Thank you. So good afternoon. My talk will be rather high level because there are many topics to talk about. I know that in the announcement I mostly focused on consistency, so we'll get there. But we will also talk about many other things related to complex engineered systems. So I'm not going to talk about complex human systems, like the human body and the human cellular system. Okay, so maybe the thread to my whole talk will be that we will deal with complexity by modeling everything explicitly. Sort of a mantra, no? Model everything explicitly. Don't leave any knowledge implicit. And do so at the most appropriate levels of abstraction. When I study cars in traffic, I can study them as mechanical systems, use differential equations to describe their dynamics. Or maybe I'm interested in the queues that form in front of traffic lights, and maybe in that case I will use some queuing network abstraction level. Maybe I need different formalisms, maybe I use differential equations, queuing networks, and so forth. And it turns out, certainly in large industrial problems, we need to explicitly model the process. The process, the combination of activities, different engineers working on different parts of a problem, that needs to be modeled explicitly, otherwise total chaos will result. And of course, my sort of fundamental research is on modeling language engineering, the semantics of modeling languages, the efficient implementation of modeling languages and tools. But it's really about how do we support the modeling, with modeling and simulation, the design of complex cyber-physical systems. And by cyber-physical, I mean that they have cyber software components, that they have physical components, that they have network components, and that it's more than just the sum of the parts, that something comes out of there which is much more complex. So it's all about, actually it's about breaking through these silos, the silo of an engineer, a mechanical engineer, a software engineer, a control engineer. Somehow we need to have more integrated approaches. In the early 90s, we had a basic research working group which looked into the future of modeling and simulation in Europe. And one of the ideas that came out of that was that we would need multi-paradigm modeling. And multi-paradigm, actually, the definition is basically this. Now, more recently, I'm the chair of another European network, Multi-Paradigm Modeling for Cyber-Physical Systems. Actually, this name, multi-paradigm modeling, was coined by myself and Peter Mosterman, who's a research director at the MathWorks. So this is our little group. And now you may have wondered why, what is this thing here? It's a beer glass, because I'm Belgian and so I have to promote Belgian beer. And we do practice what we preach. We do model everything. We build tools which allow you to design modeling languages. And from these modeling languages, we can build models. These models can be simulated. And this here, I'll come back to that in a second. This is an example of a tool which we generated for the modeling of the production of beer. So we do practice what we preach, we model everything explicitly. And this is, by the way, this glass is what we give to, I'm going to make some free publicity for our summer school on domain-specific modeling. And that's what we give to our participants. I'm also...
Do you model consumption as well?
We practice consumption. No modeling, that's sort of the extreme form of modeling. I'm also part of this summer school on this is a large European project trying to provide open tools for modeling cyber-physical systems. It's partly based on Modelica and part on VDM. Okay, years and years ago, we worked on building a tool like this, which is for the design of bioactivated sludge wastewater treatment plants. So you will notice through my talk that automotive examples, robotic examples, biological examples, they're all intermixed. Again, we practice what we preach, there is heterogeneity. We should be able to, with our maxim of model everything at the right levels of abstraction and so forth, we should be able to deal with these kinds of systems too, where bacteria are actually used to digest dirty water. Now, this is what I, in retrospect, found out, because after working on this for several years, I found out this is actually a domain-specific modeling environment. It's not a general purpose, it's not MATLAB, it's not Simulink, it's very specific. You have specific building blocks. This is an aeration tank where air is blown in and bacteria eat the dirty water. This is a settler and so forth. Now, this is for people who design such wastewater treatment plants, this is the language they speak. And they are maximally constrained, but by being maximally constrained, they can't really make mistakes. They don't have to write differential equations. They anyhow don't know about differential equations. We can maximally generate optimized, in this case, simulation code. Okay. Now, in retrospect, this turned out to be domain-specific modeling. This is, by the way, the commercial version today of that same tool. About half the wastewater treatment plants in the world have been built using this tool, it turns out. Now, this is a model in a modeling language, and maybe I'll take a step back and say something more about modeling languages. And David Harrell and Bernard Trumpe some years ago, 2004, wrote an interesting paper in IEEE Computer called Meaningful Modeling. What's the meaning of meaning? What's the semantics of semantics? And so if I look at my wastewater treatment plant, that's the real thing, and I want to model this using something like this. This is, of course, a bit simplified, but the essence is dirty water comes in, it is mixed with bacteria, these bacteria actually see that dirty water as food, they digest it, they burp some nitrogen gas and so forth, and they grow, they get into this settler, this tank where the heavy bacteria go down and do their work again, and the clear water comes out, floats on top. So I can wave my hands and say that this is what this means, but for a computer, this is just a drawing. Yeah. So what is the meaning? Well, I'm going to give the meaning in a translational way. I'm going to say, if you want to know what this means, well, this is what it means. And what you see is where there used to be a mixer, I now have put a sum. So I've actually given a mathematical, in this case in a Simulink block diagram, causal block diagram, I've given a meaning by giving mathematical equations, but in this case in this synchronous data flow form. Okay, but then you might say, oh, that's all, and now I see variables appearing and so forth. But you might say, what's the meaning of this? Well, if you've used Simulink, maybe you will immediately give a meaning to this, but intuitively. But if I want to know what this means, I'll have to translate it again. I translate it to this. Because in some sense, you can all imagine that this here means that the sum of what comes in must be what goes out. And so I can write down these equations, and this is what it means. So ultimately, we've taken this domain-specific diagram, we've mapped it onto its meaning, and we've mapped this onto its meaning, and ultimately we've arrived at this. And now, of course, I need some numerical solver to come up with the values for these variables. And typically, they will be time-varying variables. Now, there's another way of looking at this. Like this here, this causal block diagram, synchronous data flow, we can say, well, you're cheating a bit. You're mapping it onto this and then saying, well, magic occurs and we can solve this. I could also try to give an operational semantics. I could try and come up with an algorithm which assigns values to all of these variables, these signals. So the operational semantics in this case, here I'm actually taking a MATLAB Simulink block diagram. In this case, it takes a constant, it's a very trivial and useless example. It makes the product and it adds it, and you have a feedback loop here. There's a delay in there, it takes the previous value, it multiplies it by one and it adds it. And then we have a scope. And actually, if you run this, which is really looking at the meaning of it, you get, at least for this signal here, you get something which increments over time, yeah? Because we have a delay and we have a feedback loop, so we keep adding 1, 1, 1, 1, 1 to this. Okay, so you could say that the meaning of this is actually the signals, all of these signals, I've picked out only one. And now if I want to go from this to, for each of these signals, the actual values over time, well, maybe I should operationalize that. I should give an algorithm which can take this as input and which produces these things as output. Okay, well, here it is. It's a very, very naive algorithm. We start with time, should not be time step, at time zero. While not end condition, we will keep incrementing the time. That's what you see here. The time, in this case, doesn't increment by one, but a fraction of one. We keep incrementing time, and at every point in time, we actually walk through the graph, which is made up by this. We walk through it in a particular order. Ah, which order? Well, of course, from things that are known to things that are unknown. And these are known, so we can push these values, then we can multiply them, we push it through here, and so forth. So that's where this dependency graph building, loop detection, and so forth, leads ultimately to a schedule. In which order do I walk through these blocks? For all the blocks in my ordered schedule, I will ask the block, take your inputs, produce your outputs. Okay, and then we increment the step. Okay, we increment the time. So this is an example of operational semantics. We give meaning to a model like this by providing an algorithm which does some computation and produces signal values in this case. Okay, so which is better? Well, typically you have a combination of both. Typically what will happen is you will start with something like this. You will say the meaning is, this is of course very much constrained. I map it onto something more general. And then here I will apply my operational semantics and I will get signals. Yeah. And so actually I'm going to summarize this a bit. I'm going to now draw this graph with languages. This first model was a wastewater treatment plant model. I gave it meaning by translating it, compiling it, translating it to a causal block diagram. So this is a block diagram. And I gave meaning to this block diagram by translating it two differential algebraic equations, that's what I did here. Here I finally gave it meaning by generating these equations. This is in red, this is translational semantics. What we can also do is, we can have a solver for algebraic and differential equations. And this will give me continuous time, or discrete time, signals. That's the meaning. We could also, that's what I showed just now, have an algorithm, operational semantics for CVDs, which maps onto this. Or I could actually do this for wastewater treatment plants. Now, this seems a bit tricky. Why would I basically reinvent the wheel? Because here there's knowledge of numerical methods. Why would I incorporate the domain knowledge, the numerical knowledge, and so forth? Why not traverse this graph by going from wastewater treatment plant, for example, to CBDs, and then doing the operational one? Or maybe going down here and then doing the operation. Yeah. So there are many choices, and it depends which one is optimal. It may be that going down here allows me to do certain symbolic manipulations, computer algebra, which would not be possible there. Yeah. So, maybe it's best to go here. I certainly wouldn't do that because that's too wide a gap and I want to stand on the shoulders of giants, namely people who wrote Simulink, for example, and I just want to map onto Simulink. So there's this divide and conquer. Julius Caesar did it, so why not us? Divide and conquer, we will actually split up the problem of simulating, giving meaning to and simulating wastewater treatment plant models. We split it up into mapping onto CBDs, and then of course, hopefully someone else has already done this for us. Of course, there's a price to pay. Right? The price to pay, of course, is that debugging, for example. Well, yeah, okay. If I give an expert in wastewater treatment plant modeling, if I give him a causal block diagram, they will panic. No? If I give them differential equations, they will panic even more. Yeah? So we need typically traceability so that whenever something comes out of here, it is via going up and feedback is given at the right level. Okay. Now, yes?
Does the wastewater treatment plant model have a meaning on its own, or is it just us?
Well, so I see where you're going, because if this already had a meaning, we will have to prove that it's equivalent. Yeah? In this case, this is a specific domain where I've worked with biologists, and they've told me this is what it means. And so we built up this library of building blocks and of mappings, and so they've said this is what it means. Now, of course, is this really what it means? This brings us actually into validity, because then you have this model of something in the real world. I will have to calibrate it so that I can really match what happens in the real world. And whether it is the right meaning, in this case, it's more a question of, does this accurately represent, within some given tolerances, the behavior of that system? Yeah. So in this case, I had the luxury of inventing the semantics of this language, because they did not, the bioengineers did not have any formal semantics. They had papers where they wrote differential equations. Yeah. And so we sort of pulled this up all the way there. Yes, but I see where you're going. In some cases, there is a language with already a given semantics. And then of course, if we use this translational approach with all the advantages of doing analysis and optimizations and so forth, we have to prove that they are equivalent through some bisimilarity or whatever it may be. Yeah. Now, there's another reason why I really need this. Suppose someone gives you a wastewater treatment plant model, and another one, and a model of a controller, which is actually described as a CBD. I've drawn this in different colors. This is a network of components, and they're in different colors because they're in different languages. What does this mean? I have no idea. What I will do is I will say, let's look. Oh, one of them is a CBD, and the other two are wastewater treatment plant models. Maybe if we map them all onto a common formalism, then maybe at the level of that common formalism, CBDs, or even I can go lower, differential algebraic equations, there I know what it means to couple. I know what it means to couple. Here, I don't, and they're not directly connected in this case. But if they were directly connected, I wouldn't know what it means. But we can maybe give meaning more easily by mapping onto a common formalism. Okay, where a notion of composition exists. Yeah. Yes?
So the wastewater treatment plant model, mm-hmm. is that a model which is executable, or is it more like a specification or capture of
In this case, that's a very pertinent question, and I'll come back to the essence of it, I think, a bit later when I talk about requirements. Because indeed, we need to not only model, possibly at a domain-specific level, not only the design, but also the requirements. In this case, it's a design. It's a description of how I pour concrete, I make tanks, I have stirrers in there, and so forth. That thing I could build in reality, I now build in the form of a model. I push the button, I simulate it, and it should do the same as the thing I can build in the real world. And of course, I can now, through design space exploration, try thousands of variants of that design, analyze its performance, and only once I find the good one, the best one, I will finally start pouring concrete. Yeah? So in that sense, it is a model of a design, and of course a basis for optimization, design space exploration. It is not a model of a specification. It could be, it always, there are two sides. You could say, no, it's a specification for the guy who pours the concrete. Yeah, and because it gives me an architecture which can then be used to do the actual implementation. When we come to embedded systems, this will become more obvious. Okay. Maybe one last remark about this is that the poor man's approach to combining heterogeneous components is, of course, what is the common level? Well, the common level will ultimately always be the signals, the behavior. And so that's why we get, this was a picture which I drew many years ago about how you could couple bond graphs, differential algebraic equations, state charts, and so forth via a formalism called DEVS. But it also shows that I can always take a simulator for partial differential equations, for finite state automata, and so forth, and each of these generates trajectories, and maybe I can do the composition at the level of the signals. So you orchestrate these simulators, which compute the evolving signals, and it's at that level that you do the composition. Now, you've lost a lot of information there. This is more and more domain specific, more and more optimizations can be done. Here, you've lost a lot of information. And forget about proving stability, accuracy, and so forth. Well, you can try, but this is typically easier at higher levels. So this is called co-simulation, and is currently very popular in industry. There's a standard called the functional mockup interface, but a fool with a tool is an even greater fool. There is a great danger of combining simulators and getting complete nonsense out. Nonsense at the numerical level, incorrect results, unstable results, but also at the physical level that you combine numbers, but which actually are representing physical quantities, and there are conservation laws in physics which are all of a sudden violated. So there's a lot of interesting research going on now on how to improve on this by adding, of course, a little bit more information. Okay, yes?
Just to clarify your previous slide. So if you say that WWTP is a design, actually. And then
in this case, these are languages in which indeed I describe a design, yes.
So they could be executed, I guess, and then...
Yes, like here, this is a design, this is a particular design, yes.
So could this be executed by itself and you'll be able to see the signals? Or
yes, and here you see this, for example, this is ammonia, nitrate, and so forth. So you're doing a virtual experiment. You're saying for this architecture, with these parameters, pump speed, and so forth, what is going to happen? Yeah.
So the question I have is in the slide on that, if you can go back to that slide,
This one.
So you show a direct green arrow from top to the continuous time signal.
Yeah.
And then you also have another differential algebraic equation.
Yeah.
So is that a different way of representing the same thing?
Yes.
And you have two different simulators, which are...
Yeah. The thing is, of course, this has to commute, because of course, whether I build this, or I build this, or I build this, they must all end up with the same thing. Yeah, because this wastewater treatment plant, that model must always have the same meaning, and the meaning is ultimately, like in the case of this simple block diagram, this is the meaning. So all I'm saying is there are multiple ways of getting there, and these multiple ways of getting there, this becomes important for optimization reasons. And it becomes important once you have heterogeneous systems. Because then maybe things which seem unrelated, by mapping them onto the same semantic domain, I can meaningfully combine them.
My question is, won't the wastewater treatment plant model already be using underneath it a differential equation or differential algebraic equation, or would you do it differently?
The thing is, of course, ultimately, you want an engineer, and this is also what this tool does, you want an engineer to focus on their problem, which is to optimally design something. It's like, what is a car? It's something which brings us from A to B. What is a wastewater treatment plant? It's something which turns dirty water into clean water in a reliable way, even if there are spikes and so forth, in a reliable way and in a cost-effective way. And I'm now interested in coming up with many different designs and picking the best one. Now, how do we evaluate which is the best? Well, through simulation, through numerical simulation. But I would like to reason about alternatives, not at the level of equations, but at the level which is as close to my domain as possible. Because in many cases, the people who design these things, they don't have any clue of the equations underneath. And it's just a tool for the engineer to come up with better designs. And of course, with automated design space exploration, we generate many alternatives, structural and parametric alternatives, and fully automatically come up with optimal designs. So that is, but you're right, initially these were designed back of the envelope or in a spreadsheet, no dynamics, just steady state. Then some people did this advanced simulation with differential equations, but then they got lost in the numerical aspects, which are none of their business. They're interested in designing these plants. They got lost in there, or they wrote equations. This is actually one of the things which often goes wrong here. At this level, we're talking about physical systems. And there are conservation laws. What goes in must go out. Energy conservation, mass conservation, and so forth. Here, this is mathematics. I can perfectly write valid equations, which are simulatable, which violate the laws of physics. So this is one of the reasons why I want to be as close as possible to the domain. And of course, it means that when I'm modeling here, hopefully my tool will already keep me from modeling nonsense. Here, a modeling tool here or here will not keep me from modeling nonsense from the physics point of view. Yeah, because this is mathematics. This is mathematics. Yeah. And so the MathWorks, for example, the commercial vendor, they offer not only Simulink, but they have SimMechanics, SimHydraulics, SimEvent, and so forth. And these are also hard-coded, in this case, domain-specific modeling environments with a lot of knowledge of the domain. Okay. So this is a plea for domain-specific modeling. Now, in my abstract, I think I said something about linguistic. What I mean by linguistic is each of these models are basically elements of a set of possible models in that language. For example, wastewater treatment plant models. But these wastewater treatment plant models, they need meaning. That's the semantic mapping meaning, which maps onto, in our case, signals. And they also need a textual or visual representation, concrete syntax. Now, why am I showing this? This is to make it a little bit more theoretical, but actually also because I grew fed up with building by hand these modeling environments. I want to generate a modeling environment like this. I want to generate this. I want to specify somehow all the knowledge of what the components are, what can be connected to what, and so forth. And then I want to push a button and I want to get this. So rather than spending years building this, I want to, in one afternoon, generate this. So I would say that today, after a few decades of research, this is sort of state of the art now. You can generate such an environment. This is called meta-modeling, and you can generate syntax-directed modeling environments. Okay. This is all leading up to something. This is leading up to the fact that any of these, that a modeling environment for this language can itself be explicitly modeled. Remember I said with my beer glass, model everything explicitly? We really eat our own dog food. We model our modeling environments. And good things happen. Then I can analyze them, then I can generate them, I can optimize them. So this is what we do, and let me see if this works. With a bit of luck. Oh, and I'm never going to get this back. No, okay. Oh, no. That is not exactly what I want. Can I run it on? I'll keep it like this. There's some cool music, but I will spare you the music. So, by the way, this was for a conference and it had to be a teaser, so hence the sort of over-the-top comments. So what we're doing here is, this is a web-based modeling environment in which I model, in this case, a game. You have agents, players, artifacts, and so forth. I have modeled all the entities that can exist in that game. And I'm also, for each of these entities, I'm giving them what they look like, little icons. And I've described what can be connected to what and so forth. All of that was flashing by. And now I have pushed a button, and I have generated an environment in which now I can start building these a game. It's a tile world in which these things can be connected, and heroes can walk around, pick up keys, and so forth. So let me pause a bit. So this is a domain-specific modeling environment. It's a modeling environment in which I can have these worlds of tiles, in which there are monsters, there is the hero, there's a door, but I can only get to that door if I first pick up that key, and only then I can get to that door, which brings me to another world, and so forth. And ultimately, there's the pot of gold at the end, and I want to get there. So, actually, in about an hour or so, or an hour or two, I was able to model what the entities are, what they look like, push a button, and have a modeling environment like this. So, okay, this is now state of the art, this is possible. It's a domain-specific modeling environment, but this is now a language, like the wastewater treatment plant language, which has no meaning. We would like this to be a game with dynamics, namely, the hero moves around, gets killed or doesn't get killed, picks this up and then goes through that door, ends up here, and so forth. Now, the beauty is, we're going to give meaning to this, and this meaning, if it's translational onto PetriNets, for example, is analyzable. We can prove, for example, that there is reachability, that the hero can go and pick this up, can go to, if this is not there, I shouldn't even try to play this game because you will never get through that door. So there is a dependency analysis you can do, a reachability analysis, so showing that you can ultimately get there, because a game which never ends is very frustrating, is a bad game. So I can do analysis, but I can also do animation. I can actually generate, in our case we generated for an Android phone, you can generate an application from this. We do this by transformation. Always, like a compiler takes C code and generates machine level instructions, we can also do this at a higher level. We can take such a specification and generate C code, for example. So this is what we do. We describe the operational semantics in this case by means of rules. And a rule is basically something like this. You find a pattern and you replace it by something else. You take the state of a system, you change it. And the state may be a value, but it may be a complex graph structure. That's where graph matching comes in. So if I find this pattern, this was a bit too fast. If I find something I can pick up, I then pick it around. So okay, this went quite quickly. This was actually the game being played. So this is the dynamics. And on the side, you see the semantics. This is a rule followed by a rule followed by a rule. Try this rule as long as you can. And you see this is for debugging purposes. It's like the transformation which moves things around is actually modeled here, and we can animate this. Okay, now it turns out that we also support collaboration where multiple people can work on the same model and give it the same or different semantics. So there was an invitation sent to someone else, and now you can see in this case that they were both looking at the same model. Well, this was just, I'm still just setting the stage for my story about consistency. Okay, so this is this tool, AtomPM, and of course we can build languages which are a bit more complex than what you've seen up to now. This is a model of a nuclear plant, and we did some safety analysis on this. So this was then translated again to PetriNets, and well, then also translation to differential equations. Depending on what you want to do, you can then translate this to an appropriate semantic domain. Okay, so what I've actually said up to now is that we can have these languages with all the elements in that language, all the models in that language. We can actually generate a modeling environment for it from models. These are so-called metamodels and models of the concrete syntax. And if we want meaning, this is the meaning onto the behavior, we also need to somehow specify that that meaning. And we do this by modeling this transformation. That's what I did with these rules. Okay. So this is the state of the art. We have our tool to do this. If you find this pattern, replace it by this pattern. This gets efficiently executed on arbitrarily large graphs. And we've also implemented this in commercial tools, like in this case in Simulink. If you find this pattern, replace it by this pattern. In this case, a continuous model by its discrete approximation. And now we come back to your question. And this is something which is very often overlooked. We do all this. I was on a PhD committee in Geneva of a student who had worked at CERN on the Large Hadron Collider, and they had developed a domain-specific language to describe their very, very complex sensor networks. Okay, all very well. And they were doing consistency analysis on it, correctness analysis, by mapping onto PetriNets and doing analysis. The only problem, and this was beautifully developed, the only problem is that their domain-specific language was a design language. And then finally, behind the scenes, this gets translated to a particular kind of time PetriNet. And then you had to write an LTL formula to describe the property you were interested in. Now imagine, this is a simple example of an elevator which moves between three floors, and you can push buttons, and the elevator can of course be at different floors. It's a very, very simple domain-specific language to describe the behavior of an elevator. Okay. The problem is, if you
want to check, given such a model with its semantics, you want to check that whatever button is pressed, eventually, in the fullness of time, the elevator will arrive there, you have to write something like this. Okay. Now, there's a complete mismatch. This is beautifully close to the domain. This is not beautifully, awfully far away from the domain. So you need to be an expert in model checking. You need to know LTL. And actually, it's so large because we have to enumerate over the different floors. What I would really like is this. For all floors, after a button is pressed asking to go to that floor, eventually the elevator reaches that floor. And at that floor is, I have a label here, an O, and the O is the same everywhere, which shows that for all floor, it is after I want to go to that floor, eventually I reach that floor. This then, by an appropriate compiler, gets compiled to this. Yeah. And this is where, of course, we get into testing, runtime instrumentation, and so forth. We get to the essence of having appropriate languages not only for design, but also for properties, and hence for requirements. Yeah. And this is something which is often overlooked. Both are necessary. Okay. Now, we're getting a little bit closer to what I really want to talk about, namely multi-view consistency and contract-based design. So a lot of what we do is commonly known as model-based system design. Yeah? And you have all these models of different parts of your system. Typically, you have a physical plant, an embedded control physical plant, controller, and then the possibly non-deterministic environment. And ultimately, I design a controller and I can simulate, I can actually do model in the loop, software in the loop, controller in the loop, hardware in the loop simulation. We use a DSpace hardware in the loop simulator for this. And finally, you deploy onto the little ECU embedded controller in your car, for example. So that's all very well. Why am I talking about this? Because first of all, you see a lot of heterogeneity here, different components at different levels of abstraction. So that's one problem. Possibly these are developed by different people. And there's another problem, this problem of going from a functional description of what you want to an actual deployed one. Because this is very much resource constrained, memory constrained, power constrained, you name it, there are all these constraints. So there are problems of heterogeneity here, and there are problems of deployment. How do we deal with this? Because all of these lead to rather interesting problems. This is our little prototype of our power window. I was asked to put my head in this. Because supposedly it's supposed to back off, but no one has ever tried. I've tried my hand, it works, but because we actually proved, but this is of course interesting, no? We have proved that our control algorithms are safe. But proof is one thing, and putting your head through there is something else. I'll show you the actual requirements for this in a minute. Okay, we use a particular standard called AutoSAR, and then we do schedulability analysis and so forth. This is all to say that even for something as simple as a power window, this is quite complex. Because there are mechanical components, there are electrical components, there are power components, it draws power. There are software components which have to reason about, is this safe? If there's an obstacle detected within, there are laws which state, or directives that state, how soon you need to detect it and how soon you need to back off. So there are safety requirements. There are maybe optimality, power requirements. All of this comes into play. And ultimately, I want to realize this. So I start from some very early stage requirements, and ultimately, I have a working system. How do you do this? Well, it turns out this is a map of all the languages used. The C language is there, but also some domain-specific languages. 28 different modeling languages were used. Okay, that's one. That's already for something so simple. Because the mechanical system is modeled in one way, the electrical system is modeled in another. You could argue, well, I'm going to model it at the level of differential equations, anything physical. That's fine, but that's certainly not optimal. I would like a toolbox for modeling mechanical systems, for electrical systems, and so forth, because maybe I can do optimizations and analysis specific to that domain. But ultimately, by the way, you see CTL here. I'm actually doing safety analysis, so I'm using not LTL, but CTL as the language to describe requirements, safety requirements. And what you see is that there are transformations, that we take a model and we turn it into another model, we turn it into another model, and ultimately somewhere down here is C. I don't remember where, but somewhere probably down there should be C. C code here. So we ultimately generate C code for our controller. Of course, we had models of the physical part, but ultimately that then gets built. The only thing which really gets synthesized is the C code. Now, these are all the modeling languages. You see, you have textual requirements. We start with a Word document, then we go to use cases. We have a domain-specific language for the environment, for the plant, the physical plant, for the control. We go via state charts from which somewhere code is generated and so forth. This is just a map of the modeling languages and the transformations between them. Remember the wastewater treatment to CVD to differential equation. This here is, and in systems engineering, this is of course commonplace that in COSI community, I mean the systems engineering community, this is a workflow model. These are activities. Model the plant, model the controller, and so forth. These are things which are done by humans. That's why they're in gray. They take artifacts like a requirements diagram, a use case diagram as input, and they produce as output, in this case, a model in the language control DSL. And then the yellow ones are fully automated. What we try to do is to develop tools, methods, tools, and techniques, which turn as much as possible into yellow. For example, I may have a DSL, a domain-specific language, a domain-specific model, but I'm actually going to translate it into state charts. Why? Because my state charts are then analyzable, and finally I can generate C code from my state charts and so forth. Now, why is it important to chart this? Once you get into concurrent engineering, you have multiple engineers working together on different parts which finally have to be integrated of a complex system. Well, you'd better know what they are doing and whether they're doing it in synchrony and whether there is synchronization required, at which point, and so forth. So even though we do get carried away sometimes in our language engineering and model transformation and so forth, the big picture is it's a very complex process. And we need to model that. We eat our own dog food, or we practice what we preach. We have to model these processes ourselves. This becomes very important once you look at safety standards. Their rigid processes are necessary, and a safety case has to be built and so forth. So you really need to model your processes. The beauty, of course, is if I've modeled my process, remember what I showed with the little game, I can do reachability analysis on this. I can check whether this is a good process. And as you will see very shortly, I can even simulate this and even do predictions of how long my entire process will take. And maybe I can even design alternatives. I can automatically, like I did with my wastewater treatment plant, come up with alternatives. I can automatically come up with alternative processes and come up with the best process. So this is one of the things we're doing with Siemens now. And so finally we come to, I have 12 minutes left to talk about inconsistencies, which is what I put in my abstract. Because it is certainly not the only, but it is a really, really tough problem in the modeling of complex engineered systems. We want to build complex systems correctly. It has to obviously satisfy the properties. And we want to do it efficiently. We want to minimize the cost of the development process. And the time to market should be minimal. These are, of course, it shows like this, the arrow should really point the other way. They are conflicting. Because obviously I can build in no time a completely wrong model or a completely wrong product. So I need to make sure that it satisfies the requirements, and I want to do it optimally. So this work is mostly István David's PhD work in a project called MBSE for Mechatronics. And actually one of the cases, we have an unmanned aerial vehicle as a case, but we also have what used to be a badminton robot. but which has now been transformed into an AGV, an automated guided vehicle. That's why you see there are lots of sensors on it. So it's something which drives around in your warehouse and picks up stuff and so forth. And so we want to do an optimal design of this thing. And we want to choose the battery, we want to choose the motor and so forth. And of course we have certain requirements. It must get from A to B within so much time and so forth. So, of course, more general, in this case, for example, we didn't have to do computational fluid dynamics, CFD calculations. When you're designing airplanes, for example, things you have to get much more into the solving of PDEs. Here, this was not an issue. We could stick with lump parameter models. In the case of our UAV, we actually do have these complex simulations of the efficiency of the turbulence around the wings and so forth. So what you see is that there are many, many different kinds of models. This is, for example, a state chart model of a controller. This is a model of the physics and so forth. This is a model of the very detailed physics. All of these models might be inconsistent. What does it mean to be inconsistent? An inconsistency is present if two or more statements are made that are not jointly satisfiable. It's a failure of an equivalence test, a non-conformance to a standard, or a constraint and violation of physical or mathematical principles. It's basically because two or more modelers basically do things which are incompatible. Yeah? And this happens, of course, once you work on large projects and you have multiple people working at the same time on different parts of the same system. This is Sebastian Herzig's definition. He was at KTH and now he's at JPL in JPL NASA in the US. And I think this is a nice description. It is not jointly satisfiable. There is some conflict. And now, rather than thinking about removing inconsistencies, maybe we should relax that a bit. And Finkelstein said we should manage actually inconsistencies. We should maybe for a while allow inconsistencies, because you cannot keep a mechanical engineer and an electrical engineer constantly in sync. That would be very inefficient. Maybe you allow them to work, to drift a bit, and then you do a check, and you resynchronize. So the question is, how do we manage these inconsistencies? I should even have put, well, he said manage consistency, we say manage inconsistency. You tolerate in certain regions of your system design, and for certain periods of time, you tolerate inconsistency. So that's our main contribution, that we say you should do this. Now, so what we do is, here's this tolerance, managing inconsistency, that's our approach. And so we have this whole theory where we actually look at, this is a trivial example of that AGV, this automated guided vehicle, where you have a battery mass and a motor mass and a platform mass. That's that platform you saw with a motor on it and a battery. That's the total mass, and that must be somehow smaller than some number. And of course, I can play with this. The people who, of course, are designing the electrical part, they will worry about the battery. And the people who design the platform, they will worry about the mass and what it looks like and so forth. But of course, they do this independently. And yeah, so it's perfectly possible that by changing this, maybe I have to adapt this. Actually, maybe I should go a step further. Maybe there are these cyclic dependencies. If I want to move faster, probably I need a bigger motor. If I have a bigger motor, it will draw more current. So I need a bigger battery. Same thing around the other way around. If I want a longer range, I need a bigger battery. But then maybe this will have impact on how fast I can get somewhere and so forth. So there are all these dependencies which we try to make explicit, and then we do the dependency analysis, and we somehow, this is the workflow, this is the process, somehow we will modify the process to make sure that inconsistencies don't persist for too long. So I won't go too much into detail in how this is done. We have papers about this. But it's basically all graph analysis, dependency analysis. And we have different types of, I think this is not very readable, we have different kinds of knowledge. We may know that two variables are related, and that if you change this, that should also change. that's an L0 relationship, all the way to knowing exactly the mathematical relationships between them. And depending, of course, on how much knowledge I have about the relationships, I will be able to do clever things to manage these consistencies or inconsistencies. Now, what is interesting is we will minimize costs. So what we want to do is we want to come up with a workflow which maybe it keeps us from being inconsistent. It makes things really sequential. I have a process where the mechanical engineer can work and no one else can work. Then the electrical engineer can work and no one else can work. This is, of course, not very efficient, but we can guarantee there are no inconsistencies. If I make things concurrent, of course, that opens up the possibility of lots of inconsistencies. So what do? We actually have all these dependencies, we have our process, and we actually build different alternatives. For example, this is an alternative where we do things in parallel. And we also have to model, these are the actual artifacts. This may be a CAD model or so. But what I'm going to come to is, this was the L0, L1, L3 kind of inconsistency. What I come to is the fact that we do a design space exploration of our processes. For example, this is a very simple example, activity one followed by activity two. I say, well, let's try to make these parallel. Let's put them in parallel. Now, the beauty is, this is obviously faster than this. Now, instead of doing things sequentially, I do them in parallel. The only problem is that itself leads to the need of managing inconsistency, because this will undoubtedly lead to inconsistencies. So how do we do this? Either we now have to insert another activity which will detect if there are inconsistencies, and if it finds them, go back. That's a risk. Or maybe we use, that comes next, contracts, which will make sure that we make sure that these work in such a way, through contracts, that they will not become inconsistent. So that follows next. You see something behind here. What is this? You've seen all these processes here. These are workflows. Each of these are activities, and they take time. We have given meaning of this in terms of a discrete event model, a sim-events model, where each of these has a model of how long it takes. And so we simulate, so here's this model. This is an automatically generated sim events model. And if you simulate this, it will tell you something about how long the process will take. So remember what I said here, we do design space exploration over the processes. But of course, if you do design space exploration, you need a way of evaluating what is better than what. So you need a quantitative way of figuring out how long this takes, how long this takes. So that's why we have a discrete event model underlying this, which can be used to quantify how long a process will take. Okay, now, yes?
So your design space exploration is also in terms of simple rules like this? Is it a local design space?
So in our case, our approach currently, there's two kinds of, it's indeed pattern-based. So on the one hand, we look for patterns like these. They're sort of design patterns. Sequential, turn it into parallel. And on the other hand, we have more complex patterns which reason about the relationships via these dependencies. And we detect these and we say, if there are no dependencies, the parallelism is okay. If there are dependencies, maybe you need to insert a block where you will actually go and check if there are inconsistencies. Yeah. So, and of course, this is the problem, like within optimizing compilers also, you might optimize one way and then that leads to a remediation which is needed, which again undoes what you've done. And so it's there may be backtracking in there. So I realize this may be confusing. This is design space exploration at the level of the processes. We're trying to optimize our process. Before, when I talked about wastewater treatment plants and so forth, and quickly go back here, there is deployment space exploration, there's design space exploration. This is in the product space. We want to come up with an optimal power window. The other one is we want to come up with an optimal workflow. And this is for companies like Siemens who build tools which support the workflow management tools. This is, of course, very important. We're almost there. Another approach, as I mentioned, is rather than tolerating inconsistencies, then checking whether there was an inconsistency, and then fixing, you could also work based on contracts. You could say, we're going to have very strict rules. The suppliers, the people who build components, they will all have very strict rules of what they do, and if they stick to that, we guarantee that there will be no conflict. Yeah? Okay, so avoiding inconsistency in multi-domain development by contract-based co-design. This is Ken van Erpen's PhD on this project. And here, finally, I should have shown this earlier, these are the requirements. The power window should start moving within 200 milliseconds after a command is issued and so forth. Detecting a clamped object and so forth. And you see there's mechanical aspects, control aspects, embedded aspects. And some of these requirements have impact on all of them. Some of them have only impact on some of them. Yeah. And so how do you make all these different engineers in their different domains, how do you make them work together in a way which does not lead to inconsistencies, which leads to a correct product, and which is optimal in time? Yeah. Okay. Now, maybe a short clarification. There are horizontal inconsistencies and vertical inconsistencies. Remember, we went from high-level specification to ultimately a deployed system. Inconsistencies here are called vertical, these are called horizontal. An example, for example, I have components. Well, this one assumes that the current is between 0 and 1 and 10 ampere, and this one assumes it is between 0 and 20. This is a problem. They've been happily designing, optimally designing their components, but when they are connected, this should not happen. So maybe they should have agreed upfront about their interfaces. And that's already a first hint at contracts. That's horizontal inconsistency. The vertical inconsistency is that a control engineer may reason about things like settling time, whereas someone on the board will reason about sampling frequency. And again, there may be inconsistencies in their reasoning about these two. Maybe by choosing the wrong sampling frequency, I may not actually be able to satisfy the requirements out there. So this is what is called, in the context of deployment, going to more and more detail, realizing something that's called vertical inconsistency. And so what we say is we will use contracts, and contracts are based on, in computer science, in the Eiffel programming language in the 80s, there is this notion of require and ensure or assume guarantee. And there is now a theory, which was developed mostly in France and at Berkeley, about how to do this for cyber-physical systems. Now, this is very much a theory, and we're trying to now make this theory usable. This was Alberto Benveniste mostly who worked on this, and so this is our contribution. We work with assume and guarantee contracts between the builder of the component and the user of a component. And of course, remember, we're talking about cyber-physical systems. This is not just, like in computer science, a value which has to be between 0 and 5. No, they're signals, there may be all sorts of constraints which need to be satisfied. Now, we're going to use upper ontologies. And what are ontologies? Ontologies are ways of classifying the world. Is a supervisor, well, for example, myself and Paul de Meulenaere are in the set of supervisors, PhD supervisors. Actually, what is special about ontologies is that typically they use, especially if you use description logics, they use an open world assumption. You will classify the world in things that satisfy this property as a supervisor, things in the world that do not satisfy that property, and then the third one, that's the open world assumption, the I don't know. And this is quite important, that if you reason about the real world, that you explicitly say there is a third option, which is I don't know. It turns out that is quite crucial. Now, why do we need this? Well, you've seen that we give semantics to a model like this by operational semantics, in this case, by running a simulation, and this gives us signals. Remember, this was a block diagram. We get signals, and then we can analyze that signal, and we can check, this is, by the way, the backing off, I think, of my power window here. And does it back off quickly enough? Is the reaction time less than 1 millisecond? If it is true, we say, this is safe. Now, the problem is that this reaction time here is a variable in some model. Yeah. This is what I would call linguistic. Yeah? We have a model in a modeling language. We have an operational semantics. This gives signals. I can then test if a certain requirement is satisfied. Okay, that's one. That gives us true. On the other hand, we have the ontological view of things. Is this system safe? Which actually does a classification of the things in the world which are safe, which are unsafe, and the I don't know. It turns out that once you put engineers in different domains together, they may be reasoning about the same notion of safety, but they don't realize it because they're lost in their specific language and their specific variables and so forth. So what we do is we say you need not only your modeling and simulation technology, but you need at a higher level these so-called upper ontologies to make the link. And so what we do now is we build tools which give these different engineers, mechanical engineer, electrical engineer, control engineer, give them indications that something is going wrong by making the link via these upper ontology notions of safety and so forth, by making the link between something in this world and something in this world, like the control engineer and the hardware software engineer. And so these are these ontologies there. This is a tool, Protégé, which we use to model these ontologies at the control level, at the hardware level, and the link between them. This is for vertical consistency. And so, yeah, we have all this tooling which allows the engineers to collaborate. And this is very much about embedded systems. So ultimately, schedulability analysis is run and so forth. Okay, so this was a very much a whirlwind tour, starting from model everything and a beer glass, model everything at the most appropriate levels of abstraction using the most appropriate modeling languages, and processes are important too and should be modeled too. And then I've gone into these complex cyber-physical systems. I've explained a little bit about language engineering, modeling language engineering, and sort of the state of the art which allows us to really even design new domain-specific languages. And then I've gotten into this particular problem of consistency, where we try to come up with ways of dealing with inconsistency so that we ultimately still have a correct product, but also that we have it as quickly as possible. And we've seen two ways of doing this. The one is by changing our process, trying to detect when there are inconsistencies and then fixing them. Or the other one is the avoidance. It's like with deadlock. You can try to completely avoid it by, in this case, having contracts. And in that case, I don't need to check if there are inconsistencies because we have proved, because of these contracts, that they will not occur. Okay, so this is a bit of our work. We do some basic research funded by these agencies. We work with a number of companies. And of course, the tool builders are Siemens and Mattworks. We work quite a bit in automotive. We are now part of something called Flanders Make, which is the sort of industry 4.0 for Flanders, for tiny little Flanders. My end, I don't think I have it. Usually I bring back this slide, but I forgot. The message to take home is that you should model everything explicitly at the most appropriate levels of abstraction using the most appropriate formalisms. Okay, thank you.
It's not very clear to me what exactly you mean by consistency. So is it that you have interfaces specified for each component and then you check whether those interfaces are...
So the general definition, we try to go back to first principles, no? To this general definition that in principle, at any point in time, you do not want to have two statements which are conflicting.
Right. Huh? Suppose, for example, I have a requirement which says that the power window should back off with one.
Right.
And I have a system design which does something. Right now, how do I check whether these two things are conflicting or inconsistent?
Yeah. So, because typically these inconsistencies are there at the behavior, because the semantics is the behavior. How does this thing work? So ultimately, I have to, in practice, run a simulation and check, the signals are like this. No, it doesn't. satisfy my requirement in this case. Okay.
You're already testing.
In this case, okay. This is one approach. That's sort of the poor man's approach. I run the tests. I check yes or no. Of course, you might want to do this in a model checking sense. You would like to prove this or guarantee this. And that's where these contracts come in. If you build a component for me and I can somehow reason about meeting my safety requirement of backing off within so much time, I know that in my architecture, in my composing building blocks, I will be able to meet this. If your component satisfies some sub-requirement and we agree that you're willing to do this for me, and that means I push it down to you, I put other constraints on you, and you just guarantee them. Well, and so it propagates up. And so that's where you can guarantee that these inconsistencies will not occur. Now, of course, the question is, it's all very well to talk about an automaton and its properties. Talking about hybrid systems, this is something else, no? Will I be able to reason about these in a compositional way? I don't know. There are limited cases in which this works. There are others where this doesn't work. And also the fact remains that maybe at some abstraction level I am able to reason, but ultimately the physical system, if I reason about continuous systems, non-linear continuous systems, this becomes difficult. But that's where, in my title, I said engineered systems. What engineers very often do, what we as engineers do is, we, by construction, make it work. Maybe the optimal design of a receiver and amplifier of radio exists, but we don't do it that way. We have a component which is the receiver, we have an amplifier, a pre-amplifier, post-amplifier, and we design them, we over-design them in such a way, so it's not cost optimal, but in a way that they can be composed, and with impedance matching. So we design for reusability. And I think this is, in engineering, the saving grace, so to speak, because we come up with an infrastructure which is maybe not optimal, but which allows us to guarantee correctness or so. And so in the context of cyber-physical systems, there's some interesting, well, one of the instigators of cyber-physical systems is Janos Stepanovic from Vanderbilt, from ISIS. The group is called the Institute for Software Intensive Systems, was started 20 years ago. And all of a sudden, the name took on another meaning. But anyhow, so they, together with some control engineers, they believe that cyber-physical components should use something called passivity design. This is from control theory and passivity-based design. And then, even for these cyber-physical systems, it would be possible to have some form of compositionality. So again, it's by construction, but that's a different talk in its own right.
So we'll just close the formal session now. We have some coffee and it, so we can continue interactions with Professor Hans. So thank you very much again for a
thank
very
you.
Interesting.
Hello, nice to meet you.
The one who did his postdoc in Italy.
Ah, yeah.